We're extremely fortunate to have a person like Mr. Siddharth Bharadwaj to speak to you, because you don't get people like this so easy. So here is Mr. Siddharth Bharadwajan. He was a former editor of The Hindu, and he's an academic, writer, quite a lot. So he'll be speaking to you about the critical issues before Indian journalism. Which road do we take? He'll be speaking about for about an hour, and after that you should ask questions, interact with them. You know, he will not be speaking to a wall. He'll be speaking to people, youngsters, as journalists, aspiring journalists. So please interact. Please welcome Mr. Siddharth.
Thank you very much. It's a great honor to be here today at the Vakkam Maulvi Foundation, and on the occasion of the launching or the discussion about inaugurating the Swadesh Abhimani Media Study Center. For me, it's of course a multiple honor and privilege. Not only have I been invited to come here and address a gathering like this, which I think any journalist or any editor would appreciate, but to be given the opportunity to lend my name to the work of the Vakkam Maulvi Foundation, and in particular the Media Study Center named after the Swadesh Abhimani newspaper, is a really special privilege, a special honor. Because in many ways, if you look at the history of Vakkam Maulvi himself, the creation of this remarkable, short-lived but remarkable and well-loved newspaper called Swadesh Abhimani, the relationship between Vakkam Maulvi as owner and Ramakrishna Pillai as editor, the conception of editorial independence, the relationship of trust that developed between the newspaper and its readers, these are all questions which today are as important for India as a country, and for us as journalists. Because when we speak today of the critical issues facing journalism in India, we do so in full knowledge of the fact that the media today is in the middle of a crisis. And I think we need to be honest about it. Whether we work within the media in whatever capacity, as journalists, as photographers, as editors, as camera persons, or people associated with the internet desk, or if we are on the business side of media, or if you are a reader or a viewer or a consumer of media, the fact that all is not well, the fact that the media situation is not healthy, is an open secret. Because once you lose a media that is willing and able to shine a light on what is happening around us, you undercut the democratic foundations, the liberal foundations of society. So what are these four pillars? Well, the first one is the business model. Any media, in order to survive, has to be financially viable. If its financial viability is under a cloud, or if there are questions about the business model, then these have to be addressed. The second pillar Equally important, editorial independence. What is the value of having media if media is not going to be independent, is not going to function as an independent editorial entity that takes decisions about what to cover, what not to cover, how to cover, driven purely by the professional assessments of those who are trained in journalism and those who have the public interest in mind. So editorial independence is the second pillar. The third pillar is, again, equally important, which is of professional standards and ethics. So assuming we have a healthy business model and assuming we have editorial independence, are we as journalists willing and able to work according to the highest professional standards of our craft? Are we prepared to follow the highest ethical standards that people expect of journalists? That, ladies and gentlemen, is the third pillar. And the fourth pillar is the pillar of public support. Because you can be viable financially, you can be independent editorially, you can be ethical, or you can be professional in your conduct of journalism. But if the public distrusts you, if the public is unwilling to support you, then it becomes very difficult for media to survive. I can't speak with any great degree of specificity about the media situation in Kerala, or at any rate the Malayalam part of it, but I'm willing to wager that the manner in which these four pillars have weakened across India is something that is familiar to you in Kerala, and perhaps you see elements of this one way or the other in your work as journalists or in your reading and viewing as members of the public. And it is to each of these four pillars that I want to spend a few minutes trying to understand more precisely what it is that is weakening the business model, editorial independence, professional standards and ethics, and public support. But let me start with the last. There was a time when journalists and journalism was, it never paid very well. I don't think parents would be very enthusiastic back in the 30s or 40s or even in the 60s, 70s, 80s or 90s if their children came home one day and said, you know, I don't want to be an engineer or a civil servant, I want to be a journalist. It's not that parents didn't respect journalism as a profession, I think they did. They had the highest regard for it perhaps, but there was a feeling that there's not much of a living to be made. That our salaries, is there job security? Are the salaries decent? So there were concerns of that kind, which is why families were not over-eager to push their children into journalism. But whatever hesitation somebody had was not because they questioned the merit or the value or the worth of journalism as a profession. Paradoxically, today, when salaries are much better than they were, say, 20 years ago, they may not be great even now compared to engineering or lawyering or medicine and so on, but I dare say they certainly are better than they were 15 or 20 years back. Perhaps people higher up in the food chain are paid much better than those who are lower down in the editorial rung, but I would say that salaries have improved over a reasonable period of time. But paradoxically, today, despite salaries having gone up, despite there being a mushrooming of journalism schools and various kinds of mass media or communication institutes and so on, the perception among the public about journalism and journalists is not what it used to be. It's much lower today. Sure, there is some degree of admiration for the superstars, so a television anchor may be recognized at an airport or on the street, and people may say, oh, yeah, that's a famous person. But there is a sense which has become entrenched, say, over the last 5 or 6 years, because of various negative media practices that have come to light, that journalism is somehow a compromised profession. That we write or show what somebody pays us to write or to show. Or that we wield the power of pen or camera, not so much to highlight the truth, but to push a certain agenda, which may be political, may be corporate, some bias or the other. I'm not saying these allegations are true. I'm not saying this perception is true. It may be true for a section of the media. Some of you, perhaps all of you, are familiar or may be familiar with the Radia tapes, which came out about 5 or 6 years ago, which showed the very close nexus between, or the kind of cozy relationship between corporate PR and politicians and bureaucrats and journalists. It wasn't very flattering to my profession, to our profession, to our shared profession, for us to hear audio tapes of journalists being too cozy and too trusting of corporate communication or PR. There was an instance of a very famous editor and columnist who virtually took dictation on a corporate story where one Ambani brother was fighting the other, and the PR person of one brother managed to push her point of view over the phone, and sure enough, that person then reproduced those arguments in a newspaper column pretty much without reflecting critically by himself on what he was doing. So we've seen that, public saw that, and this has in a way fueled the idea that the media is somehow not very responsible. People also resent the way in which certain high-profile incidents were covered. I think the Bombay terrorist attack and the excessive competition between television channels to be first with the story has created a certain irresponsible reporting culture. You are all familiar with the way in which operational details of what the security forces were planning in dealing with some of the terrorists who had attacked Bombay in 2011, in 2009, television was kind of showing this live, and we know subsequently that the handlers of these terrorists were actually watching live television coverage of what was happening outside the Taj Hotel or the Oberoi or Khabal House, and were communicating in real time information to terrorists on the ground about where to go and where not to go, where the threat from the security forces was coming, and so on. So that was another low moment, which showed that not necessarily the desire to curry favor with corporate houses, but this race to this overly competitive nature of media, the race to be first with new and exclusive details, was turning the media into a somewhat irresponsible player. And the public didn't like it. Public watched. It's not that the public didn't watch this stuff, but the public also realized, or subsequently when the government or people in power, for the reasons of their own, chose to attack the media, this became a very useful case to cite as an example of the irresponsibility of the media. So today, I would say among a reasonably large section of the viewing and reading public, there is a certain cynicism about journalism. I don't think people trust what they see or what they read in quite the same way as they used to 20 years ago. And this weakening of the bond between media and public even if there are valid reasons for this, is a very dangerous development in any democratic society, or certainly in a society like ours, where we know that those in power do not respect the rule of law, and media is needed to highlight injustice, inequality, corruption, criminality. If the media cannot do that from the vantage point of credibility and have support with the public, then you can imagine how easy it would be for those in authority to get away with what they are doing. So I think that this pillar of public support, which has eroded because of a variety of reasons, is something that is very dangerous for the structure of media and media functioning in India. But let me look at the one that I began with first, the business model. If somebody were to come from abroad and look at the Indian media scene and say, well, how many newspapers are published? What's circulation like? How many TV channels exist? How many websites are there? They could be forgiven for getting the impression that the Indian media scene is bursting with good health. You have something like 800 plus daily newspapers. The circulation of virtually all these newspapers today is higher than what it was 10 years ago. Many of these newspapers have opened multiple editions that did not exist 10, 15 years ago. The paper that I used to edit, which is the Hindu, back in the day, used to have only Chennai and Madurai edition. Even Madurai used to be flown from Chennai in a special aircraft. Today, the Hindu publishes from, I think, 16 cities across South India, plus Calcutta, plus Delhi. If you look at Matrubhumi, Malayalam Manorama, some of these papers have, you know, 7, 8, perhaps even editions that vary from district to district. And naturally, as content has become more local, as delivery has become more efficient, circulation has gone up. If you look at television, I was trying to draw up a mental list. You have 5 24-hour private television news channels in English. If you add Doordarshan, Lok Sabha, Rajya Sabha, etc., and the business channels that are there in English, you have at least a dozen 24-hour English language general news or business news channels. In Hindi, the number is probably double that. Every language of India has perhaps anywhere from half a dozen to a dozen or even 15 or 20 news channels, which are either 24 hours or devote some chunk of their daily programming to news and current affairs. So by a conservative estimate, we're looking at perhaps hundreds of news channels on television. Now, why, despite this very huge number, am I saying this is not healthy? Because the vast majority of these channels do not make money. When Prasar Bharati did a survey about 3 years ago of national English and Hindi channels, they found that other than TV Today Group, and largely on the strength of Aaj Tak, which was the first Hindi channel to start, and which had a first mover advantage, virtually no national television channel in English or Hindi made money. I wonder what the bottom line is for news channels in Tamil or Malayalam or Telugu, where you have cutthroat competition, limited ad market, which is splintered. I doubt very much if huge profits are being made. Now, the same is roughly the case with newspapers. You have 800 plus daily newspapers. The fact of the matter is that the newspaper industry in India is dependent on advertising to the tune of as much as 90% of its revenue. Abroad, in the West, for example, ad revenue accounts for perhaps maximum 60%. The remaining 40% comes from subscribers who are used to paying a reasonably high cover price. In India, the cover price not only does not cover the cost of production of the average newspaper, it actually leads to a marginal loss on every sale. The Times of India, for example, in Delhi, on average, it has a pagination of about 42 pages, sells for 3.50 rupees, costs about 15 to 16 rupees to print. So every additional paper, every additional copy sold, in material cost alone, leads to a loss of 10 rupees, minimum. And you make up this loss because you're a dominant market player, you can charge a high tariff rate for the advertising, but not everybody can do that. So typically we know that in any territory, it's the market leader and perhaps the number two, especially if one and two together account for about 80 to 90% of total readership, which is often the case in most Indian metros. Number one and number two get the lion's share of advertising. Number three and four get hardly any advertising. The only advertising that they get is government ads. Government ads, as you know, come at a cost in terms of editorial freedom. When I was editor of The Hindu, I inherited a paper in 2012 that did not have much of a tradition of being critical of the Tamil Nadu government. And since I saw my role as a professional editor as being that we should cover every leader, every government properly, and if the Tamil Nadu government has done something wrong, then we should focus on that. So very soon, the government of Tamil Nadu stopped putting ads in The Hindu. I believe to this day, those ads have still not come back. So now The Hindu is a large paper, it can deal with that kind of pressure. But many smaller papers, I won't take names, but there are papers in Chennai or Tamil Nadu that provide the most craven coverage of the state government. They have very low circulation, but they are always chock-a-block with government ads. So being overly dependent on advertising clearly has a downside when it comes to the kind of news that a newspaper will publish. My point is that this economic model, the business model, where whether you're television or print, you're overly dependent on advertising, creates an enormous kind of negative pressure on the functioning of free media. And that situation is getting worse because competition is increasing, not so much in print, but between print and TV. And now between print and TV on the one hand and the internet on the other. So certain kinds of lucrative advertising. 10 years ago, parents used to put ads, matrimonial ads, in the newspapers. Today, a large chunk of that advertising has migrated to online portals, shadi.com and so on. Similarly, property, motor cars, jobs, all of these were very lucrative from the classified advertising point of view. And they have migrated from print and gone online. So newspapers have begun to feel the squeeze. And as they've begun to feel the squeeze, they have begun to look at other forms of advertising, including trying to squeeze revenue out of news. Now, how do you squeeze revenue out of news? You do that by creating this phenomenon of paid news. So we saw that newspapers and even television channels began, of course, one thing, there's always been a tradition of running advertorials. But those are marked, that was a kind of gray area. There was a little bit of cheating that went on because an advertorial would be dressed up to look like news. But at least somewhere or the other, there would be a sign that said this is an advertorial. However, what we've seen over the last decade is that even news stories now are, can contain paid for features. Most of the city supplements of the Times of India group, for example, like Trivandrum Times or Chennai Times or Delhi Times are full of these kinds of paid features. If you look closely at the masthead, below where it says Bombay Times, I'm sure in Trivandrum Times it says the same thing, it'll say this is an advertorial promotional supplement, which is a polite way of saying that all the items here have probably been paid for by somebody. So that promotion of a movie, or that review of a new shop, or this gushing article about how so-and-so is the latest star in the Malayalam film industry or in Bollywood, chances are that that item is not the product of any objective editorial assessment, but simply the result of commerce. Now, it was one thing to have paid news in the sphere of arts and entertainment, bad enough. But we began to see evidence again, starting about a decade ago, of paid news entering into political reporting. So you would have stories appearing, particularly at election time, about how a certain candidate is well ahead of all his rivals, and he's a real man of the masses. You'll get these kind of stories, and you wonder, this guy, this politician sounds great. And of course, you don't know, it's never disclosed, that that politician probably bought a package, a editorial package from the newspaper, where in exchange for, say, 10 lakhs or 50 lakhs or whatever, he would have been assured 5 great page one stories, 10 photographs, 1 editorial, maybe 2 articles against his rival. We don't know, because these things are never disclosed. You can surmise, based on a reading of news items, that a certain story looks very improbable. When the press council set up an investigation team, they found numerous examples of paid news across India in different languages, English, Hindi, plus all the regional languages, often in distant editions of mainstream media houses. And this phenomenon, even though everybody condemns it and everybody denies doing it, we know that it carries on in one way or the other, and is a direct product of the financial or business model, this first pillar of media, coming, you know, that pillar, because it's weakening due to competition, you're overly dependent on advertising, and now you have fierce competition between newspapers, TV channels, and websites. So the amount of ad revenue that you can depend on is coming down. How do you remain afloat? You remain afloat by squeezing editorial for revenue. Oftentimes you see, particularly on business channels. Now, in a country like America, which has such an advanced economy, you have just CNN, which is a 24-hour dedicated news channel, and you have Bloomberg, which is a business channel, and that's pretty much it. You have Al Jazeera from Qatar, which is beamed into the US, and you have BBC, but in terms of native US channels, you have one general news channel and you have one business channel. Here you have, in English, 5 or 6 business channels, in Hindi, 5 or 6 business channels. How do they stay afloat? Well, they stay afloat by resorting to paid programming, which is never, not always disclosed. And so I'm fairly certain that paid news, or a variant of paid news, exists on TV. And we are as much in the dark about its, about the extent, as we are about the degree to which it has penetrated the print media. Apart from paid news, we see another phenomenon, and this is again true of not just national but regional media. How do you stay afloat when competition is stiff, advertising revenue is falling or not increasing, and your expenses are going up? How do you sustain a media enterprise which is running at a loss? Why would somebody want to keep open a newspaper or a TV channel that is running at a loss year after year, and where, given the degree of competition, there is no conceivable prospect of that TV channel or newspaper ever becoming profitable? The reason you would keep it alive is if it is part of a wider set of businesses that you run, in which the you take losses in your media venture, as long as you are able to subsidize it by profits from other ventures, And the media venture is useful because you can use that to further your other business interests by doing certain kinds of stories, not doing certain kinds of stories, appeasing a politician who is sitting on a clearance that you need for your factory project or mining project. So we see this phenomenon too of the media being run as a collateral, as a secondary business, in order to the media arm, even though it's loss-making, is leveraged to produce profit or to give an undue advantage to the owner who has multiple business interests. They could be in any number of different fields, transport, mining. But the idea is that somewhere or the other in your calculation, it is useful for you as a proprietor to keep alive your media arm, even though it makes losses. And I think that this tendency to be overly dependent on advertising, to use your other businesses to subsidize media, not in a positive way. I can think of, for example, in the United States, the Washington Post was bought by the owner of Amazon.com. And to the best of my knowledge, he isn't using Washington Post to further his own business, but bought the newspaper as a kind of a quasi-philanthropic and business venture. But that's not the phenomena we are seeing here. It's not as if some businessman out of a desire to promote free and independent media starts a news channel or starts a newspaper. Rather, the idea is to leverage the power that a media arm gives you to benefit your other businesses. So I think that this has contributed to the weakening of this fundamental pillar of the media, the first pillar that I mentioned, which is of the business or financial model. Editorial independence, what does it mean? It means that the owner, having created a newspaper or TV channel and decided what the broad outlook or editorial policy of this channel is, then appoints an editor whose job it is to run this in a professional manner and to exercise editorial judgment on what to cover, what not to cover, and not allow extraneous factors, political pressure, corporate pressure, advertising pressure, to color the decision of what to cover and what not to cover. Largely because of the flawed nature of the business model, we know that many media houses over the last 2 decades or 3 decades have steadily moved away from editorial independence. So they may be independent of the government to lesser or greater degree, but the editors of these newspapers or TV channels are not the sole decision makers when it comes to deciding what to play, what not to play, what to run, what not to run. You have marketing guys, you have advertising guys, you have the owners sometimes interfering, looking at stories, looking at the lineup, saying we should have this, we should not have that. And many newspapers have actually done away with the position of a full-fledged editor. Most TV channels certainly don't have an editor in the conventional sense of the term. What we've seen over the last 2 years, though, or particularly the last year and a half, is a further erosion of editorial independence taking place because many proprietors, for one reason or the other, have decided that they want to curry favor with the present government. So there is a certain fear of Narendra Modi as Prime Minister. There's a certain, or perhaps there is admiration or support or whatever reason. But we saw both in the run-up to the election and subsequently, a significant section of media proprietors took a decision that they want to see Narendra Modi as the Prime Minister of India. And they, in a way, steered their coverage of Modi, the election campaign, in that way. I'm not saying that the media alone was decisive in producing the outcome, but the media certainly helped in creating the idea, the cult of personality that was built up around Narendra Modi, the idea that he is an economic miracle maker. The reality is before you, the last year and a half, about what he can and cannot do with the economy. But there was a certain myth-making which the media helped to create and which was an important ingredient in the marketing of Narendra Modi as a prime ministerial candidate. And today, now that he's become a prime ministerial candidate, you can see how the media has begun to tailor its coverage to ensure that you do not hear too much direct criticism of the prime minister or his senior most advisor, Amit Shah, who is the president of the Bharatiya Janata Party. I wonder how many of you here in the audience followed a case known as the Sohrabuddin Kausar B case. This was a case involving a woman called Kausar B and her husband Sohrabuddin, who were kidnapped by the Gujarat police from a bus on the Andhra-Maharashtra border, taken to Gujarat, and then killed. And the police subsequently put out a claim that Sohrabuddin had been on a mission to kill Narendra Modi, who was chief minister, and about his wife, they never ever said what happened. This matter, after people protested, was taken up by the Supreme Court, which handed the case over to the Central Bureau of Investigation, which, after thoroughly investigating and interviewing policemen and police officers who were involved, charged something like 10-15 police officers of Gujarat and politicians, including Mr. Amit Shah, of murder and conspiracy to murder this husband and wife team. The investigation was supposed to happen under the direct watch of the Supreme Court. So the idea that the CBI conducted a politicized investigation because Manmohan Singh was the prime minister is not that easy to accept, because they would have incurred the wrath of the Supreme Court, which was monitoring the investigation. Anyhow, the CBI charge sheets a number of people, including Amit Shah, for the murder of these two. A third person was also killed, called Tulsiram Prajapati. Shah was also arraigned for his murder. And in an extraordinary turn of events last year, when the matter was being heard by a special CBI court, the Central Bureau of the Special Court decides to discharge Mr. Amit Shah from the case. Now, one hears, it's one thing to be put on trial and to be acquitted, right? After all evidence has been presented and witnesses have been cross-examined and so on. For somebody to be discharged before a trial even starts in a high-profile murder case of this kind, where the investigating agency is not the police, but the CBI, and not any old CBI, the CBI acting on the direction of the Supreme Court. Very unusual, very rare. I've discussed with lawyers whether they can think of other examples over the last 60 years of a murder accused being discharged before the trial even starts. Very hard to find another example. Despite that, the CBI has not gone on appeal. Now, this is a separate issue. We are concerned about it as media persons. Every night you have angry discussions on TV channels with 8 or 9 talking heads. We have that general with big mustache, and I'm sure there are Malayalam equivalents of all these gentlemen. For the local, I saw while channel surfing last night, 3 or 4 panel discussions which are modeled on the same way, a little less aggressive, but nevertheless the same thing. So many discussions have taken place in English and Hindi by national media channels. Not one discussion on how could the CBI allow this to happen. Why has the CBI not gone on appeal? I know that one channel wanted to have a discussion, but the owners got wind, called up the anchor, the discussion was canceled. So when you look at this column, the pillar of editorial independence, until now our main concern was that the editor should be independent of the proprietor and the advertising department and so on and so forth. Now we have shifted to another terrain altogether, where there are genuine worries about the independence of media vis-a-vis the government. We remain a free press, we remain a free media, but the reluctance of newspapers and TV channels to be investigate these stories, to be frank and fearless in discussing issues, presenting perspectives before their readers and viewers, this reluctance is something that adds a new and dangerous dimension to the weakening of editorial independence that was already in place in India. Sometimes, for example, in the aftermath of Lalit Gate, you can see that discussions did take place. But I am as puzzled as you might be that a large channel like Times Now for 2 weeks or 3 weeks ran a vigorous campaign on Lalit Modi, only to completely drop the issue now. So what's happening here? Is it that this issue is no longer newsworthy? Is it that the channel has changed its mind? I don't know. But the unwillingness of the media to investigate stories that may be critical of the government, including stories that would be critical of the Prime Minister and of top ministers, is something which is eroding the independence of the media. This was not a problem earlier. There were fierce discussions all the time, I dare say, during the previous government. I dare say that if A. Raja and Pawan Bansal and Ashwini Kumar, three ministers who resigned, who were forced to resign, finally put in their papers, it was the sustained manner in which the media took up this issue, as well as the opposition, of course, which is the BJP, that resulted in that kind of a development. Today, however, this is not the case. And there is a sense I have that the media is pulling its punches. Certain stories are not being reported. Stories are not being reported in depth. There's a tendency to be very superficial or to accept government statements and pronouncements at face value. And this is beginning to undermine this important pillar of editorial independence, which is really, really problematic. Let's turn to the third pillar, which is of professional standards and ethics. And here, the way I put it to you was that let's assume that financially the media is secure and editorially it's independent, and also that it has the support of the people. But if the media does not conduct itself according to the highest professional standards and highest ethical standards, then you are going to have a problem. Now, when I say professional standards, I'm trying to capture a wide variety of things, because the demands of our profession, there's the demand of the craft, or I should say the demands of journalism per se. How do you approach a story? How do you gather information? How do you make sure that all sides of the story are represented? How do you make sure that what you report is something that you can independently verify and that you're not simply taking dictation from a government or NGO? So that's one aspect of professionalism. The second aspect is your ability to keep track of the changing nature of technology. That is also an important ingredient of professional standards. Today, when digital journalism is redefining the way in which we perform our tasks as journalists, can we say with confidence as individual reporters or editors or photographers that we fully understand this medium and its potential? Do we know how to use Facebook and Twitter? Do we are we using social media as a way to not only put out our stories, but also to find out what is happening? And that's a double-edged sword, because a lot of information on social media can often be inaccurate, sensational. I find after ignoring social media for 5 or 6 years, today the media has gone the other extreme, where any old rubbish that is on Twitter or Facebook, without too much of fact-checking, ends up becoming a news story. So when I say that we need to pay attention to professional standards, I mean not just the craft of being a journalist in the traditional sense, of being objective, but also of being able to move with the times as far as technology is concerned. And here the burden is as much on the reporter as it is on the editor, as it is on proprietors. Are you equipping? For example, we see in many media houses, there's a demand by owners that one reporter should double up as a reporter. They should file stories 10 times a day for the web. They should carry on their smartphone. They should take videos. So that the kind of job that was done earlier by a reporter and a photographer, and that too to fit in with the 24-hour news cycle. Today, demands are being made on journalists that you have to be fast, you have to be quick, you have to update your stories. If something happens at 11 a.m. in Trivandrum, a major story, you can't, and you may be working for Matrabhumi or Hindu or New Indian Express or Times of India, you can't, you don't have the luxury of roaming around the whole day and then coming into office by 8 o'clock like we used to do in the old days. Then you sit, you chat with your colleagues, and finally the news editor gets after you, so at 11 o'clock you give your story. Those days are gone. Today, if some incident has happened in the city at 11 o'clock, chances are that television will be showing it almost immediately, and your web editor will be harassing you. Where is the story? We don't want to use PTI. Or maybe PTI has not even filed it, because PTI doesn't have as much of a network as a local newspaper would have. So as a reporter, you have to go to the spot. Under quite difficult circumstances, you may have to type out a small story, maybe on your phone. And you know, under that demand for you to be quick means that you are under enormous pressure to sacrifice accuracy for speed. When I say being professional in an era of evolving technology, how can we continue to be accurate and objective and apply the tools of our trade that were originally designed for a once in 24-hour news cycle? How do we deploy those tools for the era of digital journalism, where I may have to file six times a day on the same story? So digital forces us to be fast, but digital also helps us to correct mistakes. You make a mistake in a print story, and all hell can break loose the next day when the story appears. And you cannot correct it for another 24 hours. And during that time, the police may register a case against you. Somebody may file a defamation case. You may start a riot. Who knows? In digital, you get a fact wrong, you can update it quickly. I've started a website called The Wire, where, as some news portals in America and Britain do, when we make a change, we like to inform readers that this story has been edited to fix this error. Don't have to reveal everything, but certainly the reader needs to know or deserves to know that the story has been continuously updated or edited. But digital journalism, digital means allows us to be fast, also to fix errors, provided we're willing to address those and be transparent about it. So these are some of the challenges as far as professional standards are concerned. Unfortunately, the race to be quick, particularly on television, means that either an insignificant news item, a gas cylinder may burst in Mathura, but because the local reporter phones his news editor, and this news has come 2 hours after the Gurdaspur terrorist incident, the temptation for that channel to say blast in Mathura, breaking news, is very great. So one channel puts it out, every channel then says, "Arey, kya hai?" And they go and they start putting out this kind of story. Can be quite incendiary, can be quite inflammatory, quite apart from being inaccurate. So, and we've seen many TV channels often jump to conclusions in their race to be first to report certain kinds of news items, or we see in the race to differentiate themselves. Because if you don't have news, how do you separate yourself from the rest of the pack? The news may be just, you know, for example, Narendra Modi meets Nawaz Sharif in Ufa, and they decide that India and Pakistan should resume dialogue. That's the news. How do you compete when that's all you have to go by? Well, you compete by spinning the news, by editorializing. And we see a disturbing tendency by TV channels once the basic news has been assimilated, to switch into editorializing in their coverage. Today, it's very difficult to come across a reporter in Hindi or English. I can't speak for Malayalam. But it's very difficult to come across a reporter in a Hindi or English TV channel who is reporting, say, a terrorist incident or a political development, who is not actively presenting her view or his view on air instead of sticking to reporting the fact. In newspapers too, we see this tendency to editorialize, either through headlines or through the way a story is written. Sometimes this is done subtly, which is fine, but sometimes this is done in a very blatant way, where the line, the dividing line between news and views gets erased. And I see disturbingly the tendency on the part of a major section of our media, when confronted with the challenges of the digital age, right? The challenge is that now everybody gets the news right away. So how do I compete? So I compete by being aggressive in my opinion mongering, by editorializing. I'm not against providing analysis or providing a perspective. The website I run, The Wire, when we set it up, the idea was to also do reportage and analysis, but because we haven't quite raised any funds yet, our ability to hire reporters or to pay for reporting is very limited, so we haven't really had much reportage. But what we certainly do offer is analysis and perspective, but it is clearly marked that this is a commentary or an analysis. It's not masquerading as a news item. So we feel that if you give analysis, it helps the reader to understand a certain development. So if Gurdaspur attack has happened, or if Yaqub Mehmet's death sentence has been confirmed, media can and should be able to provide readers with an expert perspective that is sober, objective, balanced. Could well be his or her opinion, but presented in a rational and calm manner. I'm not against that. I think that's a very useful function that media has to play and needs to play. But to mix up analysis and opinion on the one hand with news reports on the other is, to my mind, to undercut the integrity of news reporting. And increasingly we see that the way in which particularly TV channels are reporting certain kinds of developments, there's a lot of editorializing, and that is taking the place of factual reporting. Now, I started my talk by speaking of these four pillars of media that are holding up this fourth estate of ours: the business model, editorial independence, popular support, and professional standards and ethics. And it's clear, I hope, that each of these pillars, as I've explained, is coming under one kind of threat or the other. Given the integrated nature of these pillars and the integrated nature of the threats, it's very clear to me that if we want to choose a good path for the media, we cannot rest on dealing with any one of these pillars alone. If we want to correct the way in which things are headed, we have to fight for editorial independence. There needs to be a discussion on rational, sober, sensible business practices. We need to discuss and see what we can do to win back public trust in the media. And most of all, because bulk of you in the audience are journalists, we have to ask ourselves what we can do as reporters to adhere to or to conform to the highest professional and ethical standards as journalists. Because in my experience of 20 years, this is the one quality that you as a reporter bring to the table when you join that job. Like when you're hired by a newspaper or a TV channel, you are not the one deciding on editorial independence. You certainly are not the one deciding on the business model that this newspaper or TV channel runs on, nor can you be responsible for the degree to which the public trusts media, because you're just one person. But what you do bring and what you do control at the point that you enter and at the point that you stop being a journalist is the professional standards and commitment to ethics that you believe in yourself as an individual. That nobody can take away from you. You can learn it, you can learn and you can improve on the professional front by going to journalism school or acquiring domain knowledge. I'm a great believer in journalists at some point in their career. Of course, it's very difficult to specialize because if you join at the lowest rung of the ladder, you get thrown into covering all kinds of issues. But you should consciously try to say, okay, fine, this is what interests me. I'm interested in, it could be a narrow subject, sanitation in a city. It could be women's rights, could be education, could be primary schools, could be rocketry, since you're in Trivandrum, could be nuclear issues, could be foreign policy, whatever it is. And even within foreign policy, it could be that you decide you want to become a specialist on the Maldives. But do cultivate one or two areas of expertise that you try to become an expert in. You read available literature, you take part in and try to understand the debates around that topic. Even if your editor doesn't give you that responsibility, you also have to pick your battles. So your editor may ask you to there are all kinds of minor ethical issues that happen. An editor may want his friend's book reviewed and for you to write a positive review. That's one kind of pressure you may get. Or the editor may say that minister's son has run over a boy, don't report it. That's another kind of pressure. It doesn't take, you don't have to be a rocket scientist to see the difference between these two kinds of challenges. So learning which battles to fight. I'm not saying you get on a high horse and say, no way, I'm not going to listen to my editor on this book review. That may not be a battle worth fighting, quite frankly. But when that minister's son runs over a pavement dweller and you are told that you cannot report it or to write a story saying the driver was driving the car, that's when you have to put your foot down. So that adherence to professional standards is the one pillar that each of you as individuals contribute to you. And that, as I said, that cannot be taken away from you unless you choose to cede control over it. If you choose consciously to abandon professional standards or ethical standards, then no matter how robust the rest of the media system is, such a media system will not survive. But broadly speaking, my sense is that unless as a collective, so in other words, as individual journalists and also as journalists who interact with each other at different fora, could be in the press club or through this wonderful venture of the Media Study Center, we can try to have a discussion going on what are the challenges that we face. The challenges could be of a micro nature. I'm not saying that every time you meet, you're discussing all the woes and troubles of the world, but there could be specific challenges coming up because, let us say, you are confronting the municipal corporation officials have stopped responding to RTI requests in Trivandrum. So as a collective, even though you all compete with each other in your beat, finding, associating yourself together under the auspices of the Media Study Center, this could serve as a platform for the exchange of opinion, for discussing how to move ahead, how to improve the standard of reporting, how to improve the quality of information flow. There are lots of issues that journalists coming together could do that would contribute to the media as a whole taking a more healthy, more secure path towards its future. With these words, I'd like to stop and thank once again the organizers for